brought to you from Melbourne, Australia. This is the Badminton Podcast, a community for badminton players by badminton players, where we talk badminton, celebrate local heroes, interview players from all walks of life, and push you to grow as a player and a person. Introducing your hosts, Jeff and Henry.
Hello, our dear badminton community, and for those who might have stumbled upon us, welcome to another episode of the Badminton Podcast, proudly sponsored by Volant Wear. My name is Henry.
And I'm Jeff.
We're the co-founders of Volant Wear, the brand that offers the most versatile badminton apparel. And we'll also be releasing our very own racket soon too. So if you're looking for badminton clothing that you can confidently wear on and off the court, and a slick racket as well, then you need to check us out. You can find us on www.volantwear.com and on our social media channels at Volantwear, V-O-L-A-N-T-W-E-A-R. And today we've got an interesting person on, and I will leave it to Jeff to introduce him.
Hey everyone, thanks Henry. Just hope everyone is staying safe during COVID-19. Didn't want to bring that up, but I just kind of slipped out that it is a topic that is on everyone's minds at the moment. So I hope that everyone's staying safe. And even if you can't get out to the badminton halls, to make sure that you do your physical training at home, because there's plenty that you can actually do. So look, today's podcast guest is someone that I've had the privilege of working with in the past, not that long, but in the past few months. We actually went to the World Championships together in Basel, and his name is Daniel Fan. Daniel is a former Australian men's singles representative. He represented Australia at several international tournaments, namely the 2019 World Championships, where I was actually his coach, the 2017 World University Games, the 2019 Indonesian Masters, and the 2019 Australian Open. He was born and raised in Perth, Western Australia. And besides badminton, his hobbies are shooting hoops, longboarding, and customizing sneakers. He's currently studying a Bachelor in Sports and Exercise and Rehabilitation at Curtin University. And he's striving to be part of a badminton academy that produces successful international players.
It's quite hard saying this, especially to badminton listeners and badminton lovers. I didn't really have a joy in playing the game. I call it my superpowers. I didn't have that. I didn't have that superpower with me. So I definitely had to adopt a different way of playing, but the pain was a little too much for me. And I guess being stubborn about it didn't help the situation. I kept pushing it and making it worse until I finally got told that the best thing is to rest, especially long term. There is a life after badminton, so I had to make the call then and there.
Hey Daniel, thanks for being on the podcast.
Hey guys, how are you going?
Are you impressed with your resume there?
It was a lot of words, a lot of I appreciate that. Yeah, it's good.
Good to know. Daniel, can we quickly start by talking about customizing sneakers? It's not really something that me or probably, I don't know about Jeff, but I have no idea about customizing sneakers. So shall we start there?
Yeah, let's start there.
I saw something on Facebook about it and I think I liked your page.
Oh, I appreciate that. Yeah, I think it's an acquired taste, to be honest. Well, I'm kind of a sneakerhead, a poor man sneakerhead. I follow the NBA a lot. So a lot of NBA players are sneakerheads and they've actually started customizing their own shoes to stay ahead of the game. So I'm quite arts and craft. I started doing that and just picked it up as more of a hobby and a relaxation tool. So I started after my injury, which was recent, I started picking up that a bit more and decided I could probably make a bit of money off it. So yeah, just started up a little small business in my room and, you know, just started painting sneakers.
Sounds like the start of Apple, just like Steve Jobs in his garage. But I don't really know much about customizing sneakers. So what do you do with the sneakers? Like if you were to sell me some shoes that I want to customize, what do you do to customize my shoes for me?
What I do is I basically ask you if you would like your shoe designed in a specific way, different colors added on, or even, you know, your favorite cartoon or your favorite show. And I try and paint it on your shoe and I seal it up nicely so it's, you know, wear-proof. And yeah, we go from there.
So if I want a pair of shoes, do you source the shoe that I want or do you get me to buy it and then bring the blank shoe there and then you put the artwork on there for me?
So there's a couple of options. So we could do what the first one you said was I source the shoe myself and then I do the artwork, or you could source it for me and then you ship it to me. That's a bit more costly with shipping involved. Or, you know, if you're local in Perth, you could just find me, hit me up and we'll arrange a meetup and I can do the customs for you and send it back to you.
Oh, that's pretty cool. So in terms of the painting that you do, so you do that all by hand and you do basically, you've got the right paints and that yep. stick on the shoe properly, waterproof, yeah. et cetera, wearproof, sunproof, all that kind of stuff?
Most definitely. We've got special paint called Angelus paint. It soaks into the leather. So it's quite flexible like the leather on the shoe, and that way it doesn't flail off. It's water resistant. It's put a varnish. You put a varnish or a protective layer over it so that, you know, you can wipe dust off without smudging the paint or the artwork. It doesn't get scratched as easily as well. And it's also water resistant that way.
Oh, cool. What's the strangest thing you've had to paint for someone?
Oh, not really strangest. I reckon the coolest thing was like a Spider-Man, the latest Spider-Man movie. They asked me to do kind of a design on that. Yeah, that was probably the strangest or the coolest one I've had.
Mm-hmm. Cool.
Does that mean you paint the entire shoe in Spider-Man theme, or is it a specific picture that they were asking for?
Some people do ask for specific pictures, but yeah, mostly the Spider-Man, the whole shoe would be Spider-Man themed. So you kind of, when you see that person walking down the street, that really stands out and you kind of know iconically that's a Spider-Man shoe.
Yeah, that's really cool. Daniel, if I know we're sort of segueing into customizing shoes and your business and
yeah.
and everything, but if I wanted to get a pair of shoes customized, where do I find you? How do I find you?
So like Jeff said, there I do have a Facebook page and it's recently new. I've also got an Instagram page. The handles are @_13ERT5. It's quite a unique name. It's kind of dedicated to my grandfather. His name was Albert. 13 grandkids and 5 children. So that's where the unique name comes from.
Cool. So make sure everyone hits him up for any customized sneakers. That's a pretty cool concept. I haven't heard of it much before, other than my friend and I at one stage, actually more my friend, his name's Sean Lim. He lives in Sydney. And if he's listening, shout out to him. He customized my chucks, my Converse chucks. And that was many, many years ago. He drew all this stuff on there. It's actually, it's pretty funny. It's good to look back on. So Daniel, before we actually get too diverted into your sneaker business, even though that's really cool, we thought we'd find out a little bit more about you as a person before we jump into the badminton stuff. So we're going to fire just a few questions at you just to see what you're about and so that the audience can get to know you. How does that sound?
Sure. No worries.
Cool. All right. First question from me. What languages do you speak?
English. And yeah, that's about it.
I was waiting for something there.
English and Australian. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Australian, yeah. English. Yeah.
Yeah.
Very good. Okay. So that leads me to next question. Who are the top 3 people who were the most influential to you?
Ooh, top 3. Number 1, probably my parents, mum and dad. They share a very similar mindset. They've played a very influential role in my life. I think about them before I make decisions and think, what would they do or what would they think? So definitely them. Number 2 that comes to mind, he recently passed away, but Kobe Bryant, very influential, especially in terms of problem solving and training and, you know, motivating myself. He was a very big figure in terms of in my head when I thought about things. I would always think, you know, what would Kobe think? What would he do? What was, how would he get the best out of you? Number 3, who would be, that's a tough one. Right now, top of my head, it would probably be my coach, Nick Kitt. Yeah, Nick would be very influential in my mind. He would, you know, I would think before I made decisions or before I did stuff, what would he think? What would he say? I try to get the best out of myself by reflecting on these 3 people, I think, yeah.
Cool. Solid answers. And yeah, definitely parents for a lot of people will be one of them, and coaches, those role models, and then someone outside your group or people have access to, like Kobe, where you can see them doing amazing things. So that is awesome. That was a pretty hard question. I was actually aiming to ask you just some quick fire fun questions, but Henry's gone rogue and asked you a really hard question. So good on you for answering that one.
Yeah, sorry, man.
You're all right. That's fine.
I went next level. sorry. Yeah, we'll go back to the simple ones. Jeff, you go. You go.
All right. So Apple or Android?
Oh, Apple.
Apple.
I think I'm a big tech noob, so Apple all the way.
Netflix or YouTube?
Oh, different purposes, I reckon.
If you had to choose.
Oh, probably go YouTube.
YouTube. Mm. Watch those BWF highlights, hey?
Yeah, watch my own. Yeah.
Sushi or sashimi?
Oh.
Did I ask a hard question again?
Yeah. Damn, Henry. Sashimi. Yeah, let's go sashimi.
Sashimi?
Yeah. Yep.
Batman or Superman?
Batman.
Yes.
For sure. Yeah.
Your first car?
Oh, it was my dad's hand-me-down. Me and my friends, we used to call it, I don't know if I can say it on this podcast, we called it the Volvo shitbox. So it was like, it was such an old Volvo. I think it was bought around the same time I was born. So when I got it, it was around almost 20 years old. It had done almost 200,000 kilometers already. So I got it at the end of its life and yeah, it was my first car.
You still have it?
No, we had to, it broke down. Couple of times.
It's not at 800,000 Ks now or something like that.
It's probably in like a tin cube right now.
Yeah. True that. Yeah. How do you have your coffee? Because you said you had one just before this podcast.
Normally order a cappuccino.
Cappuccino with the chocolate?
Regular milk?
Yeah, of course. Regular milk. Not about that skim and almond stuff. Nah, full cream.
just full to the cows. Just.
Yeah, tastes better.
What is the favorite quote of all time?
Now, I choose like it changes on my mood and my environment, but the one that kind of stands out to me was never finish in the middle, always finish at the end. I kind of use that one through like almost everyday tasks, simple things like, you know, cleaning your room, for example. I've had a lot of time to do that. You know, don't quit now, just finish it, get it done. I use that quote a lot when I was training, when you're really like struggling to find energy and motivation to finish off, you know, your last few sets in the gym or on court, just always finish at the end, not in the middle. That stuck with me a lot.
Yeah, great. And last one from me, Daniel.
Yeah.
If you weren't customizing sneakers, what would you customize instead?
Ooh, I reckon skateboards. I reckon they're pretty cool. Yeah. Skateboards. Yeah.
Not shuttles?
Shuttles? Oh, you're making me think out of the box.
Little decal on the side of the cork.
Oh, but you just run through shuttles so quickly, it'd just be such a waste, hey?
Maybe some of those sustainable shuttles that are coming out.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, you could do. Or maybe badminton rackets, customized badminton rackets, hey?
Yeah, just strip down one of the new rackets and just completely customize it.
Yeah.
Spider-Man thing.
I think they've got one of those, but yeah, could do.
All right, Daniel, let's jump into the badminton questions because obviously this is the badminton podcast, but cool to get to know you a little bit better there. So, Daniel, for your badminton story, how did it start? When did you get started? How did you get started? And yeah, let's hear it.
Yeah, so I think I was around 10 and my dad invited me to play. He came home from work and he invited me to play badminton with his mates and I foolishly thought it was table tennis. So I followed him to the rec center and, you know, I was expecting to see like all the tables set up and ping pong balls flying everywhere. But instead I just found, you know, everyone's hitting this feathered thing and I didn't know what to call it at the time. So I just called it the badminton. I was a bit disappointed at first, but I started to have a go at it and I was quite natural at the sport. Yeah, at the time, badminton wasn't my main sport. I was very much into golf. And cricket, I slowly fell in love with the sport at such a young age.
Cool. That sounds really interesting, Daniel. That was in Perth, yeah?
That's in Perth.
Yeah. So which hall did you first start playing at?
I started playing at the George Burnett Leisure Centre down the road from me.
Okay. So it was more like a multi-purpose hall, wasn't it?
Multi-purpose hall. Yep.
Yeah. Cool. And then when you said you started to fall in love with the sport, what was it that you actually loved about it? Was it that you wanted to beat your dad or what was it that pulled you in?
Yeah, well, definitely. I definitely wanted to beat my dad. I think every child would want to beat their parents at something. But yeah, I naturally excelled in the sport, I felt, and I naturally acquired skills very quickly. Maybe a bit cocky of me saying that, but I think that's what really made me fall in love with the sport. I was able to acquire skills quickly And I think at a young age, that kept me quite engaged in the sport, wanting more, wanting to feel the success of acquiring such skills.
Yeah, that's cool. Awesome, awesome. And then when you started to play more seriously, when did you decide that you wanted to take it seriously and take it to the next level? Was it when you were still quite young or a teenager?
It's hard to pinpoint exactly when, but I know probably before under 15s, I definitely told my dad that I wanted to be the best in the world. I definitely had that aspiration of getting to the top. And I think at that around year 8 or year 9, I was very hungry to push that and try and get there one day.
Great stuff. And I know that you've had some success on the court and you've been able to play for Australia.
Yep.
What would you say were the biggest achievements that you've had or the fondest memories that you'll basically cherish forever?
Yeah, okay. My favorite memories that I think about regularly are the 2017 World Uni Games in Taiwan. So that's the second biggest multi-sport event and second to the Olympics. That was such a good experience for me living in the athletes' village amongst like-minded people, people with the same ambitions as me, trying to be an elite athlete, and also being in kind of like a team environment and family environment. Badminton's such an isolated sport, but you know, having that team around me felt like I was a part of things. So 2017 World Uni Games, definitely one that stands out to me. The other two, I'm going to kind of put players on the spot here that I think about and think about regularly, is the first one would be when I beat Eddie Hung back in 2015.
So really putting him on the spot now.
Yeah, I'm sorry, Eddie, if you hear this, you did beat me eventually, but yeah. You got to let me have this one. So in 2015, Eddie at the time was, I think, the best in the state, top in the country. And I was probably second at the time. And I finally pulled one on him. He beat me several times before. And I finally got one on him. And that for me was, I think I remember like 2 weeks after, I was still smiling about that victory. I was so happy about it. But yeah, a month later, he beat me in the state titles in the final. And had to humble myself there, but because I used to idolize Eddie growing up. He's two or three years older than me. So I always set him as the person to chase and the person to follow. So when I got one on him, yeah, that was a great feeling. And the second one I think about, I'm sorry again, was Ash, if he's listening to this. It was the 2017 Oceania quarterfinals. And he was the first seed and the number one Australian at the time. And I matched up with him in the quarters. We played like an hour-long match and that went 3 sets, 20 all in the third set. And I think I just got the better of him. But to his credit, he had just won the I think it was the Newcal International the day before. And then the way the Oceania draw stood up is you had to play 2 or 3 matches in a day. So he was probably fatigued from that. And yeah, those are a couple of the memories that I cherish.
Yeah, that's really cool. That's really cool, Daniel. And when was it you're in Taiwan playing the World University Games? Which year was that again?
2017.
What other players were there? I'd be interested to hear because I've personally never been to the World University Games before. I would have loved to, but I didn't.
Yeah.
Who was there in at your games playing that is on the international circuit or has been?
Yeah, so Tai Tzu Ying was there and she was the face of the whole World Uni Games.
In Taiwan, yeah, of course.
In Taiwan, yeah. It was a bit controversial because during the games, the 2017 World Championships coincided and there was a lot of chatter about her not playing the World Champs and instead playing the World Uni Games back home for her. And I think a lot of the commentators ripped into her a lot. But yeah, I couldn't imagine choosing the World Uni Games in your hometown over World Champs, especially someone so talented like her. She could have another run at it the year after or the year after that.
Mm. So you would have chosen to go to the World Champs instead of the World Uni Games if you had that decision, Daniel?
I would have chosen to go to the World Uni Games and represent my country and be the face of the games in Taiwan.
Yeah.
Over a World Champs if I was, you know, as talented as her.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Did she end up winning with her team there?
Oh, yes. I think I'm not sure if Taiwan won gold, but I know she just destroyed everyone in the individual event for women's singles. Yeah.
And besides her, were there any other sort of big names on the circuit there as well?
Yeah. Wang Tuwei and just cover blank. He's the second Japanese men's singles player after Momota.
Is it Kenta?
Oh, yes. Kenta Nishimoto. Kento. Yeah. Kenta Nishimoto.
Kenta. Yeah. Nishimoto.
Yep. So he was there. And I think he played off Wang Tuwei for the men's singles title there.
And who won? Do you remember?
Wang Tuwei won in the individuals, but a couple of days earlier, Nishimoto beat him in the team event. So kind of a reverse.
Okay, cool. So Daniel, we've kind of gone through your badminton history and how you started and a few cool little achievements you've had in the process. But I'd love to talk about your Olympic journey because I think it's a journey that it's a long journey, an enjoyable journey, but a journey that people may not know a lot about. People might think, oh, look, they're going for the Olympics. But I know how it feels firsthand to be in the race for an Olympic Games, and it is a big thing to be a part of. So can you take us on your Olympic journey from the moment you decided to want to be in the Olympics and then basically all the steps from there until now, basically?
Yeah. So I think I really wanted to, well, I really started putting motion into achieving the Olympics around 2015. And at that time, that's before Rio Olympics. But I definitely put in the motion and made my goal achievable for the 2020 Olympics. So it gave me about 5 years to prepare for it. So in 2015, I started playing international tournaments a lot more. And I started to try and experiment and play against different types of players at different levels of tournaments. And the great thing about starting then was that I got to see other international players have a run at the 2016 Olympics. And I got to speak to them and pick their brains a bit on what it's like going for the Rio Olympics. And I kind of got information and kind of got a lot of feedback and a lot of advice from them. And I kind of plan to use that advice moving into Tokyo 2020 Olympic for my Tokyo campaign. So there's 3 years before the qualification periods restarts again for the Olympics. And I spent the first 2 years trying to really polish up my foundation, my base fitness, and get it to a respectable level where I can start trying to achieve results on the international stage. The 2017, I got selected for, again, the World University Games. And for me, that was big for me at the time. And I remember the feeling after I on the plane back home from the University Games was that I felt I wanted to be back there. I wanted to be back playing and living in an athlete's village and being amongst team members because it was such an amazing feeling. And that made me more hungry to get to the Olympics. So I went back home and really sat down and say, look, 2020 is going to be around the corner very soon. And we got to start planning for it. So I decided to go out in the end of 2018 and start to collect world ranking points, knowing that moving into 2019, that everyone's going to flood the circuit and it's going to be even harder to get world ranking points. So world ranking points expire yearly. So I kind of needed world ranking points to qualify for high level tournaments. So I went out and got points in 2018, hoping that I could qualify for high level tournaments in 2019. And I did. I got to be able to play in some tournaments I never thought I'd be able to play in, like the 2019 Indonesian Masters. I got to play qualifying round there in Astora Stadium. I also got the wild card for the 2019 Aussie Open, and I got to play Chao Tien Chen there. And then I also qualified for the 2019 World Championships, which are even more points. So I think in terms of my planning, I think I executed quite well, but where I think I did fail was more on the result aspect and more of the athlete kind of side of things instead of the manager kind of side of things. For me, I definitely felt that I wish I had a coach with me. I wish I had more analysis with me. But yeah, I felt quite overwhelmed when I was on playing and not having that type of teamwork that I saw other players have. And I think that's one area that I was let down in. But I think I definitely got the planning right towards the Olympics.
So, Daniel, sorry to interrupt here, but when did you start playing the tournaments So you started in 2018 to collect points so you could qualify for the high level tournaments in 2019, which is, yeah, which is completely what I agree with. Mm-hmm. When did you actually start in 2018? Was it, did you say late 2018?
I think it was middle year 2018, cool. But definitely started to pick it up late 2018.
Do you think that was long enough, or do you think you should have started a bit earlier? This is just a question because I was thinking maybe a little bit earlier, just from what I could hear from what you were saying. But what do you think?
I started picking up the pace of tournaments, so the frequency of tournaments, April 2018, but I definitely clumped up a lot more tournaments towards the back end of 2018, mm-hmm. just because I knew that that's probably when I really needed it in 2019 for the qualification of tournaments, because at the time I didn't feel like my level was high enough to get into the bigger tournaments early in 2019. So having that 1 year expiry date for tournament points in late 2018, that would kind of roll over in late 2019 and kind of carry me to the finish line early 2020.
Yeah. And so, Daniel, if you were to go back to it, I know that, you know, you would have wanted or appreciated a bigger support network, more analytical perspective, and a more of a focus on yourself as an athlete. Is there anything you would do differently other than those few things in terms of managing yourself as a player?
Oh, that's a good question. I mean, we can always think what we could have done better and always think that way. There's numerous things, but the biggest thing for me would, I guess I wouldn't change too much, but I would change if I had a coach with me or a manager with me at times, that definitely would have helped the on-court aspect and as well as the off-court aspect as well.
Help the audience understand, you know, where you're coming from with, you know, the lack of support network. Because I feel like most people listening, they might be badminton players, but they may not necessarily understand professional badminton and what it's like to go towards Olympic qualifications and the kind of support network that's required to achieve that. And in terms of your support network when you were vying for the 2020 Olympics, is there anything about it that, you know, you were sort of frustrated by, or that you feel you could have done better or could have been supported better by the Badminton Australia or just your network in general?
Yeah, I definitely felt like having a coach would have been a really big hand. Just having that extra pair of eyes behind you and seeing things that you can't see when you're going through the motions as a player. Having a coach behind you, just seeing, you know, having another perspective and another point of view on things. As well, I know sometimes I go tangent to the game plan that I normally have, and having a coach bring me back in or adjust my game plan during the game, that would have helped a lot. I know that when I meet up with other players, we try and help self-coach each other. But at the same time, these players, you're also competing against them. So you can't show them all your cards because, you know, one day you could play them and they'll use it against you. So there's that kind of aspect where you do hold a little bit of info back amongst players. So definitely having your own coach customize training sessions for you and customize game plan where you can discuss and go back and forth. And having that coach off court as well, sorry, off tournaments and more planning training sessions around and managing training between tournaments, that would definitely help. Sometimes I felt I was a bit too hard on myself between tournaments, and I would go out and smash out a 5K run, and it wouldn't be the best thing before playing
next week. Yeah,
you know, the next tournament the next week. Yeah, so it was more kind of external pair of eyes, kind of taming me and making sure that it's not a sprint; it's a marathon. And you know, there are parts of growth you need to go through in this journey in this year. So just having that extra person would have helped, I guess, a sport trainer as well. I felt my body was towards the middle half. Oh, it's hard to say, but I did feel my body start to give up on me a little bit. And having that sport trainer with me would have helped taper off the workload and making sure my body's fit and making sure it's healthy to go for each tournament. Yeah, those two aspects.
Yeah, Daniel, and I completely resonate with the difficulty in trying to manage all these things by yourself, being the player, being the coach, being the manager, being the sports trainer, all by yourself. And it is a big task to take on. And I think that potentially listeners may not understand or appreciate how much of a big deal it actually is. And just the challenges that you do face as an athlete qualifying for Olympics, especially from a country like ours, Australia, where there isn't a lot of support staff around you and you're doing a lot of traveling by yourself. Can you take us through your experience of what it's like? So from my experience and what I've talked to other players about, it's about playing tournaments, and sometimes you're in 10 tournaments in a row and each week you're in a different country and you're trying to play really well, but you're trying to train and improve as well, but you can't train too hard and get too tired for the next week. What are the difficulties you faced? Because it's not as easy as just going to a tournament and ropping up and playing. There's so much stuff in between you have to consider about your recovery, about your training, about your physical. So you need to make sure that, because if you're only playing tournaments, you can't really work on your physical either. So your physical fitness. So how do you fit that in? How do you fit that into what you're doing within tournaments when you're playing 10 tournaments in a row, 8 tournaments in a row every single week and you're flying to a different country?
Yeah, you're definitely right. It's a balancing act, and sometimes we don't get it right. I think especially us players, we're always hungry. So, you know, we always want to push our boundaries, we want to push our limits, but sometimes it's not the best thing to do just because, you know, we've got the tournament the next week. And if we push our limits, maybe we train hard one day, it'll cost 2 days recovery, that type of analogy. So you can't afford to lose 2 days on the circuit. So having that extra person with you would have helped for sure. You know, just a coach or a sport trainer with you just to make sure that you're sticking to the right plan. I know personally, I can be quite emotional after a loss, especially a hard loss, you know, where it goes 3 sets and things just don't end up going your way, or they get a lucky smash, or they get a lucky, you know, the game is controllable, but you do lose. I know that I do get emotional, and sometimes I take my frustration out in training in terms of the physical aspect. And that might not be good in terms of preparing for the next week, just because you don't want to go too hard and you feel your DOMS and you feel your soreness. And that kind of impairs the performance for the week after. Sorry, Jeff, what was the... Good question.
Yeah, no, it's more just about the challenges and exactly what you're talking about the lifestyle, about what you have to deal with. It's not all just the fame and the glamour of being able to play badminton internationally, which is a great thing, don't get me wrong, but being away from home for that period of time, not seeing your friends and your family, you can only use Skype or FaceTime or whatever platform you're using. But yeah, just digging a little bit deeper into what the emotions are and what the struggles are behind the life of a professional athlete going for the Olympic Games.
Yeah, so I think I'm quite lucky that my mum kind of helped me out on the manager side of things. She helps me plan out the kind of calendar. So that kind of took the edge off, but other players who are doing it on its own, shout out to Simon, Mitch, Gronya, Setiana, Wendy, AJ, and saying they're all doing it on their own. Like you said, we're all our manager, coach, sport trainer, nutritionist, you know, we're all these different hats, and it does take a toll on us. Ideally, in an ideal situation, that we are just the athlete, but because we're juggling so many different things, where do you put your eggs, you know? I felt like I got burnt out, exhausted, not necessarily physically, but, you know, emotionally and mentally, just because I had to do so many things and it was hard to manage. I did feel a huge difference in the 2019 World Championships, where I did have a team environment around me. So that's where I met you, and that's where we started our coaching and player relationship. And I did feel, I felt a sense of calmness for the first tournament in the Olympic race, and that was really good. But yeah, that's what I was.
Yeah, I'm sure the emotional challenges would be really taxing on you, and I'm sure it affects you as an athlete as well. You're gonna bring that additional stress onto court, unfortunately, no matter how much you don't want to take it there with you.
I just really resonate with that kind of feeling. At the World Championships, I personally had a great time with the team, and we had a really good team environment, but just coming back to that life as an, especially a men's singles player or any singles player where you are traveling by yourself a lot, you kind of get in this routine where you're just by yourself all the time, which is great for your own personal growth. But I do remember when I was traveling, and I've spoken to many other athletes about this, when you're traveling for long stints by yourself and then you just have one person come in, if it's a teammate, if it's a coach, and it just feels amazing just to have someone there. It's like, oh, wow, I just missed having physical interaction, which is not physical, but like having someone there physically rather than on a phone call or a WhatsApp or a message, even though now with COVID we're all kind of isolating, but and everyone's feeling that sensation of, oh well, this social distancing is really tricky, but that's how it does feel on circuit, doesn't it?
Oh, most definitely. And back to your point, you know, traveling from tournament to tournament, if you have if you start off your tournament, you know, if you plan four tournaments in 5 weeks and you start off the run of tournaments poorly with a bad loss, you can tend to beat yourself up and carry around, I call it emotional baggage. And you can take your baggage from the first tournament to the next tournament and the next tournament and the next tournament. And it kind of builds up in a snowball effect. And really, instead of looking forward to playing the tournaments, you're kind of looking forward for a training block. And that's what I really started to feel, that, you know, it's getting tough emotionally handling all these losses or these mediocre results, and I'm not hitting my goals, and it's just myself doing it. So I was really looking forward to training blocks where I had at least 3 weeks where I could just, you know, spend half a week calming down, reassessing goals, and really smash out another 2.5 weeks of training. And that's probably where I felt like I would restart my game plans, the way I play, my technique, my physical aspect. In saying that, 2.5 or 3 weeks is not enough for a training block, but I guess that's the demand of the Olympic race.
Yeah. And if we were to continue from there, Daniel, talking about, I guess, late 2019 until where you are now, can you take us through what happened and basically your current situation as far as the Olympic journey is concerned?
Yeah. So unfortunately for me, I had to call it short. I had to call it a day on the Olympic race. So unfortunately, I think it was in early June, I started to feel a niggle in my knee. And being the very stubborn and persistent person I am, I trained through it and I played through it. And I progressively got worse. So I initially thought it was just soreness and I just had to toughen up and get through it. So I wasn't listening to my body enough. So when I came back after a run of tournaments, the only free time I had was early December back home in Australia. So I got an MRI scan on my knee then. And at the time, my performances were quite mediocre. There were a couple of 3-set losses that I know that I could have probably won if healthy. Getting the scan back from the MRI, it showed that I had torn my lateral quadrant, my lateral quad tendon, about a centimeter tear. Yeah, I was in a lot of pain. It was sometimes I had to take, you know, painkillers to get through training or a match. It was a bit uncomfortable walking at points. My knee would buckle. I wasn't able to perform a very deep lunge, especially on my deep backhand side. I really struggled. Jumping and landing was also a bit of a task, especially late in the third set. You're already feeling all these couple of discomforts in terms of fatigue, mental stress, etc. And then I've got my knee as well. So it really played into my head. So I wasn't performing well. I don't really want to point out my knee, but it was a big factor and I wasn't happy with the way I was performing. So after the MRI, I followed up with the orthopedic specialist and then a sport physician. And it was all along the same lines. It's like, look, you can play, but there's no guarantee you're going to keep your quad tendon healthy or intact. So it could tear off completely. You could have a cortisone shot, which numbs the pain, but
doesn't actually repair it.
Exactly.
It's just a Band-Aid.
It's just a number. It just numbs the sensation of it. So the best, in an ideal world, the best solution is 3 months of complete rest with closed kinetic exercises. So basically on a bike, low resistant therobands, very minimal. So I had a decision to weigh up and I had about a week to think about it. And I had to assess my situation, you know, financially for the rest of the campaign and my points and my health, my body, and a lot of deep thoughts, a lot of deep conversations had to be had. And unfortunately, a bit emotional talking about it. I had to stop the Olympics. I had to call it a day just because, it's not the way I wanted to play. And it's kind of what my body needed at the time.
Yeah, I really understand and I do empathize with you because it must have been so hard to make that call after all the blood, sweat and tears, all the hours of training, all the hours of traveling, all the hours of competing, all the emotional hardship of managing all the different roles of manager, coach, player, nutritionist, sports physician, gym coach, etc. And then having the journey end like this for you because unfortunately the knee wasn't good. And if you played on it, look, yeah, like you said, it could have just torn off completely, which is obviously not what you want, not just for your badminton career, but with your life as well. So I can really resonate and I understand that pain that you must have felt and are still feeling because I can hear it in your voice about how tricky that decision was. If I was just to dig a little bit deeper though and say, Daniel, yes, it was painful and yes, you were hurting in your knee as well as emotionally. What was it that made it hurt so much? Could you define it? Was it more letting yourself down? Was it more letting your family down? Was it, what was it? What was that pain? Yeah. What was it derived from?
So it was more the fact that I know I could be doing a lot better performance-wise. Even if I came out with a loss, I know I could be playing a lot better if I just had a healthy leg, a healthy knee or a healthy quad tendon. I could definitely be performing a lot better. And knowing that I was playing not at a good level, it was kind of annoying me because, you know the problem and you know the solution, but why don't you just do the solution? Why don't you just get it over with? So the factor of, you know, I was point chasing at the time. I think I was at the time the number one Australian. I reckon I was below par to make the Olympics in terms of, I would be the number one Australian, but I didn't have enough points and time was running out. And I know in order to get those points, I needed to be healthy and perform well and have good performance and good results. But I couldn't do so because of the situation with the knee. So, you know, weighing, kind of measuring the two up as well, my mindset at the time and the emotions of it all also played a factor. And my general happiness, I didn't really have a joy. It's quite hard saying this, especially to badminton listeners and badminton lovers. I didn't really have a joy in playing the game. Knowing that I can't be, I call it my superpowers. I think I'm a quite an explosive player in terms of speed and power. And I didn't have that. I didn't have that superpower with me. So I definitely had to adopt a different way of playing, but the pain was a little too much for me at the time. And I guess being stubborn about it didn't help the situation. I kept pushing it and making it worse until I finally got told by several health professionals that the best thing is to rest, especially long term. There is a life after badminton. So yeah, I was basically, I had to make the call then and there. Yeah.
The way you put it there, Daniel, it's sort of like you're Superman being stripped of your powers. And I can just imagine that there's so many emotional push and pulls where you'll kind of be thinking, oh, what if I just keep playing on it? Can I still make it? Will I make it? But then, yeah, just not being able to be yourself entirely. And that resonates with me because when I'm on court, when I'm playing and I'm feeling fit and I don't have any injuries, I'm feeling 100% myself. And maybe that's how you're feeling when you're actually playing at your best, at your physical best, or at least without injury. Having that hold you back as a player, I can imagine that would be really, really upsetting. And I'm really sorry that's had to happen for you.
Yeah, I just want to reiterate that for the listeners out there, yes, everyone gets injured. Yes, we have to recover from our injuries, et cetera, but just the emotional toll of an injury, it's not that easy just to say, oh, I've got injured. I'm not going to play anymore, especially in the case where Daniel has invested so much time, effort, years and years of training and dollars and everything involved in it. And not even the time involved, but just that emotional roller coaster that you are on as an athlete, that you kind of keep pushing through every single day, even on when you're on a real low, because you're always thinking, okay, I'm just going to get to this low so I can get back up to the high and get to something. Because at the end of the day, my goal is the Olympic Games and that's where I want to be. And I'll ride through hell and come back just to get there. And that's the feeling. But then when you strip that away and then you can't even get on the roller coaster anymore, it's something that's really heartbreaking. And like Henry said, Daniel, I'm sorry that you had to go through that.
I appreciate that, guys. Thank you.
So I know that we've touched on something that's quite I wouldn't say negative, but quite emotional. So why don't we start discussing something that's a little bit more upbeat, which is what I've learned to deal with my failure to get to the Olympic Games in 2008. Mm. So don't worry, for all the listeners out there, I have failed in this quest as well. I have not been able to play at Olympic Games. And I know that the pain that Daniel feels, and that wasn't because of an injury. So I can't say that, hey, it's because I was injured. It's because I just actually didn't make it. So Daniel's a step ahead of me. When I look back at my campaign where I was trying to qualify for the Olympics, yes, I didn't make it, but there were so many things I learned along the way, being by myself for so long and understanding understanding about myself, traveling by myself, meeting so many people all around the world, and I've met some of my closest friends on the circuit. Daniel, if you could go back, would you do it all again, even if you knew that this could have been the result?
Oh, 100%. I would do it over and over again. Yeah, even if I had the busted knee, I would not give it up. I wouldn't trade it for the world. And like you said, you just learn so much. And without going through the experience, it's always going to be what if. I don't think you would learn these experiences if you're comfortable at home. This journey, this Olympic journey, you really have to step out of your comfort zone. And you learn so much about yourself, and a lot of the what if questions that you always had about yourself are kind of answered that way as well. Yeah, for me, it was always the reason why I wanted to do this is the way I thought about it as well was if I'm, you know, 40, 50 years old, looking back, not having done this, I would have always thought, you know, what if I had done it? What if I'd done it? Maybe I could have done it. Maybe I couldn't have done it. Going through the motions now and having been through that process, I definitely have an answer for myself. And I have a definitive answer. I can rest easy that I know that I've given everything. I've learned so much. I've taken away so much from this journey, and I can sit easy with that.
And so, Daniel, just to continue this emotional roller coaster, we have COVID-19, which has delayed the Olympics for 2020. Does that mean you're going to have another crack?
Oh, I would be lying if I told you it hasn't been on my mind. It has been on my mind. I think right now there's no certainty in anything. There's no certainty in much things in our society right now. My best answer is I'm gonna say no right now, just because, first of all, financially it's a lot. Secondly, I don't think they've actually released any criterias, or they've actually defined what's involved in the last, I guess, leg of the
race. Yeah,
the race for Tokyo. So it's a bit hard to say. And until they, you know, define it, I can give you an answer. Based on the information I know right now and knowing myself and where I am, I'll have to say no, but you never know, I guess.
Sure, it wasn't easy just to say no just then, was it?
No, not easy. No.
Not easy, yeah. Okay, well, how is your knee going at the moment then?
In December, I got the news and I was told to rest for 3 months. I couldn't have complete rest. I'm a very fidgety person. I can't be sitting down for too long. I need to be moving. I need to be active. It's been about almost 4 months now. The knee feels good. I've been able to get back into the gym before all the lockdowns, and I was able to squat at a decent rate. So I've started to get my leg strength back. I've maintained my upper body and my core strength. Put on a bit of bulk on the upper body, but yeah, the knee feels good. I need to really test it though, and I haven't done so yet.
So do you mean test it on the court or test it running, or?
I need to test it more, you know, on court, going through those explosive movements, seeing what it's like. For me, I think it's a slow process. If I was to get back, I'll need a lot more supervision over the way I go about it. But yeah, first it needs a proper test, and I think I need to also follow up with an MRI, which might be a bit hard these days with the lockdown situation and getting a doctor to recommend you go get an MRI. But yeah, I'll need that first to definitely define where my knee health is at.
Yeah, it certainly sounds like you're going to need some health professional advice before you put your knee through those stress tests, that being such a dynamic and powerful player, Daniel.
Absolutely, absolutely.
So, Daniel, you have a really incredible story, and I know we could just continue talking forever, but the show must stop until next time. And the final question I want to ask you before we finish up, if you were to go back to the 2018 Daniel, being the Daniel that you are now, what advice would you give to him? It's the butterfly effect.
Yeah, you know, if you go back and you tell yourself to not do things or to change something, you may not learn that what to do and what not to do in the future. So I think listen to my body a bit more. Right now, the injury is still quite raw and it's kind of taken up my thought process on a lot of things and the way I approach things. So if I was to go back, I would definitely tell myself, listen to my body a bit more and don't be so stubborn and hard about getting that extra session in or pushing your body to the limit all the time. Your body does have a limit, and I've definitely flirted with that limit a lot, and it's not bared enough fruits. It's caused a lot more pain than enjoyment. So definitely listening to the body a bit more.
Yeah, I think that's really, really solid advice for listeners out there. There is a fine line between training hard, which we need to do, and training too hard, which is when we don't listen to our bodies. So just being able to understand our bodies, we need to go through some discomfort and some pain in general terms to get the fitness up and push our bodies. But when it becomes a certain kind of pain that we know is different than the general soreness and the general lactic acid building up where your legs are burning, your arms are burning, your core's burning, etc., then we need to know that, hey, look, this is my body telling me something. I think that, Daniel, I think you've really been able to convey that. That's such an important message for us, especially because of, to put it frankly, what it has potentially cost you in the Olympic Games here. So thanks for the advice. I hope that the audience really takes away from that.
Yeah. Thank you, Jeff. Thanks, Henry.
So just wrapping up here, Daniel, and just a quick little plug again for your sneakers. And I also know that you're doing some coaching. So if someone wants to get in contact with you for some coaching, let's just say they're in the Perth or WA area, or they want a pair of sneakers customized with Spider-Man or Ant-Man or Iron Man or something on them, how are they going to get in contact with you?
Sure. You guys can find me on Facebook. If you just type in Daniel Fan, I've got my athlete page. I've still got that. Or you can add me on Facebook. I'm quite happy with that. Or you can find me on Instagram as well as Daniel Fan as well. You guys can contact me that way and hopefully I can respond to questions. I don't mind if people come off the street and ask me or message me and ask me more about, you know, what I've been through. I'm happy to share. I think that the knowledge needs to be recycled. And like you said, I'm doing coaching now. So I'm definitely a big believer in recycling the knowledge and giving it back to the next young generation of players.
Yeah, that's fantastic. So Daniel, from everyone at the Badminton Podcast and Volant Wear, so Henry and I included, thanks so much for being on this episode.
Thanks, guys. Really appreciate it.
So look, for everyone out there listening, I hope you've really enjoyed this episode and you've really gotten some insights as to what it's like to be a badminton player, a professional badminton player trying to qualify for an Olympic Games, because it's not just as easy as going to a few tournaments and playing and getting some results. There's so much hard work. There's so much background work behind actually doing that. And the emotional toll is very, very high. And you might not hear about that from athletes because, yeah, we don't talk about it, or maybe it's not something that is commonly asked. So I'm really happy and I'm really glad that we've been able to get a bit deeper here with Daniel. And thank you again, Daniel, for being so open about the emotions and the stress and injuries and how it can really affect not just your athlete life, but you're talking about your happiness and how it can just drain even your love for the sport in itself. So thanks so much for sharing. And for everyone out there, please share this episode with everyone that you think will benefit from it. And yeah, we're really looking forward to the next episode.
Yeah, everyone, this episode is really important because badminton's such a great sport to play, and some people may only know a certain aspect of it and don't understand what it's like to be a professional badminton player. So hopefully we can bridge that gap of understanding for all of those listeners out there. If you want to connect with us, then the way to connect with Jeff and I is to connect with us via Instagram, Facebook, YouTube, LinkedIn, and TikTok via our social media handle, Volantwear, VolantWear, as well as on our website, www.volantwear.com. We really love to hear from you in terms of all the feedback that you've given us so far as listeners and any questions that you might have. We really do like hearing from you. So if you have anything you want to ask, if there's something that you want us to ask for you, to some of our podcast guests that have been on in the past as well, more than happy to do that. So yeah, reach out and say hello, and hope to see you all on the next episode.
Thanks, guys. Thanks, Daniel. Thanks.
Thank you.
Cheers.
Thanks, guys.
Yeah.
They out.
Bye.
This podcast was brought to you by Volantwear, the most versatile badminton apparel you'll ever own.